here at Point Reyes, you know, a big part of the visitor experience, a big part of what we're protecting are pinnipeds, which are marine mammals, and seals, seabirds, whales, all these other sorts of large organisms that the public really gets to interact with. And everything that we see and know about the ocean has the potential to change because the full environment of that ocean, the chemistry of the water that those animals and those plants and those microorganisms are living in is going to change.
Ocean acidification is a difficult climate change issue because there's so much uncertainty around it. People treasure their national parks. It's a place where they seek solitude, they relate to species they would never have an opportunity to relate to. Whales and dolphins and seabirds. These are the emblematic feature of oceans for many people. They like to respond to that and to connect with that megafauna. And that can change because of ocean acidification effects. So it's incumbent on us to be able to show them that link.
Ocean acidification is a series of changes in the chemistry of seawater, and it's driven by increased carbon dioxide that's in the atmosphere and caused by human activities, whether that's deforestation or emissions from industrial processes. And the ocean absorbs a lot of that carbon dioxide.
And when carbon dioxide enters the oceans, it undergoes a series of chemical reactions that produces carbonic acid and actually makes the oceans more acidic.
So we've been able to measure decreases in the ocean pH or increases in the ocean acidity over the last 30 or so years at a couple of different research stations that are centered around the globe. And we're seeing this very consistent decline in ocean pH or increase in the acidity over time. So in general, there's consensus that ocean acidification is happening, that it's caused by carbon dioxide emissions. There's not a lot of controversy. What we're less sure of is exactly what does that mean for marine life.
We're not talking about oceans that actually are acidic to human skin. They are still safe for people to swim in, but we are talking about oceans that are becoming more acidic, and the acidification of them makes some of the building blocks for organisms that make their hard parts, whether it's shells or skeletons, out of calcium carbonate. It makes carbonate less available.
Those organisms have a harder time building their shells or skeletons. That's called calcifying. So they calcify more slowly. A lot of organisms tend to grow more slowly in more acidic conditions.
And a lot of those organisms are at the base of the food web. So if we lose some of those organisms, it could have big impacts for fish, let's say, that feed on a particular type of plankton that makes its shells out of calcium carbonate, and then seabirds that feed on those fish, or marine mammals that feed on those fish.
And we don't think that we've seen anything like this in the last 350 million years. So it's a really massive, large-scale change. It's happening in every ocean basin, in just about every ecosystem. And chemistry is going to affect just about all organisms. Our research relating to evolution or adaptation is a really active field right now. I would say that's on the cutting edge of trying to understand, can species adapt? Can they adapt quickly enough to cope with the changes in seawater chemistry?
Something that we are just starting to explore is whether within one species there might be genetic diversity that enables some of those animals or plants to deal with changing conditions better than others. So, for example, in my research, oysters that live in conditions where they already experience acidic environment might be able to withstand some of the ocean acidification, whereas oysters that live in an environment that has never experienced acidified conditions in the past and is relatively stable, they might be particularly vulnerable. If we know that certain animals or plants are particularly vulnerable, it might help us try to relieve some other stresses that are harmful to those organisms. Or if we know that one area might be particularly robust against some of the changes, we might be able to conserve those areas and try to make sure that they really do last into the future.
National parks are our highest level of protection in federal land management areas. And this highest level of protection allows us to study without the effects of development or other factors. And so having this at this highest level of protection is a perfect wildlife lab, wilderness lab, where you can conduct these studies. So we see ourselves as the opportunity for scientists to come and understand what's there that has not been impaired by development or discharge or other pressing factors.
A recent study on purple sea urchins here in California actually showed that they have the genetic capacity to be able to adapt and still persist and reproduce and grow in relatively low pH conditions. But the one caveat in this study was that there needed to be a large genetic gene pool for these organisms to be able to quickly adapt. So protected areas with relatively healthy populations, hopefully you're going to have a larger gene pool to draw from and better ability for some of these organisms to potentially adapt to climate change and minimize impacts.
Parks work with scientists to understand what changes might be occurring and the potential for changes, but that has to be translated in a form that is understandable for local communities and the broader community. When I go home at night and I communicate with my family, I usually don't want to talk about ocean acidification because it's a pretty overwhelming issue. But I have nieces and nephews and they're young and I feel responsible to communicate what this means for their future, because their future is going to be different, but it's not going to necessarily be negative. It's just going to be different.